Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Russia, A Short History by Abraham Ascher, narrated by John Pruden. Preface to Second Edition. Writing a book is always difficult, but to write a history of Russia from its beginnings in the 9th century until the most recent events under President Putin in about 90,000 words proved to be far more challenging than I ever imagined. Important events and developments that deserve more time had often to be compressed into a few sentences, and some subjects, most notably cultural and intellectual trends, had to be accorded much less space than I would have liked. I am painfully aware that these are shortcomings of the book, but I hope that I have succeeded in my main goal, which is to present a coherent account of Russia's political, social, and economic institutions as they evolved over 1,000 years, so as to enable the listener to gain a better understanding of contemporary Russia. It was in this spirit that I agreed to update the book by outlining the main features of Russian history during the 8 years of Putin's presidency. It seemed to me important to evaluate the various changes that have occurred since the departure from the country's leadership of Boris N. Yeltsin, who in 1991 led a revolution that held out the hope of a genuine democratization of Russia. The main question I have addressed in the addition to the book is the extent to which Putin pursued policies that were consistent with his predecessor's legacy, and to what extent he deviated from them. In taking this approach, I hoped to shed light on the role Russia is likely to play in European and world politics in the foreseeable future. I would not have been able to write this book had I not had the experience of teaching Russian history for over 40 years. Students in my courses have often raised difficult questions, and I am grateful to them for having stimulated me to broaden my knowledge of certain aspects of Russian history. I am also grateful to the Earhart Foundation for financial support that enabled me to devote 2 summers to the book. The staff at One World, Victoria Warner and Rebecca Clare, as well as the copy editor, Anthony Nansen, were most helpful at every stage of writing of the first edition of the book. The anonymous reader of the manuscript made valuable comments that I took into account in revising the manuscript. Finally, I would like to express my special thanks to my good friend Mark Ryoff, who read the first edition of the book with his usual care and made many suggestions for its improvement. Of course, I am responsible for any errors and deficiencies that remain. Abraham Ascher, New York, April 2008. 1. The Beginnings. For over a century and a half, intellectuals and scholars interested in Russia have differed sharply over the essential characteristics of the country's economic, social, and political institutions and its culture. Much of the time, the debate centered on the question of whether Russia was part of Western European civilization or of Asian civilization, or whether it had somehow amalgamated basic features of both. That this was not a debate taken lightly became clear as early as 1836. When the philosopher P. Ya Chedaev published the first of his philosophical letters, in which he bemoaned Russia's cultural isolation and its failure to make a signal contribution to world culture. Neither of the East nor of the West, Russia, according to Chedaev, had no great traditions of its own. Alone in the world, we have given nothing to the world, we have taught it nothing. We have not contributed to the progress of the human spirit, and what we have borrowed of this progress we have distorted. We have produced nothing for the common benefit of mankind. Chedaev's sweeping and harsh pronouncements had the effect, in the words of the political thinker and activist Alexander Gertsen, of a pistol shot in the dead of night. Tsar Nicholas I declared Chedaev insane and put him under house arrest. Among Russia's educated elite, Chedaev's pronouncements generated excitement of a different sort. Intellectuals took Chedaev's views seriously and initiated a passionate debate that quickly divided them into 2 groups, the Slavophiles and the Westerners. And in one form or another, their historical and philosophical discussions continue to this very day. An observer of contemporary conditions in Russia reported from Moscow in the Times Literary Supplement of 19 November 1999 that, in Russian intellectual life, a conversation that was cut off and redirected after the Bolshevik Revolution has resumed its course. Its basic theme? east, west, whence, and whither Russia. The Slavophiles and Westerners of the early 19th century were not at odds with each other over all public issues. For example, both groups believed that such deeply rooted features of Russian society as serfdom and government censorship should be abolished. But beyond that, they parted company. The Slavophiles were profoundly religious and revered Russian Orthodoxy, a faith they considered to be much more spiritual than Western Christendom, which they disdained as allegedly under the thrall of cold rationalism. They also disdained Western conceptions of law as destructive of the social bonds that hold society together. In Russia, the Slavophiles claimed, people settled conflicts not by litigation, but by discussing their differences in a kindly manner and by unanimous agreement. Nor did the Slavophiles believe in the efficacy of constitutional government, then widely advocated in the West, though they did condemn the arbitrary bureaucracy that meddled in the lives of the Russian people. And the Slavophiles did not favor the institution of private property for peasants, preferring instead the tradition of communal ownership of land that had evolved in many regions of the Russian countryside. They insisted that the attempts of reformers ever since Tsar Peter the Great in the early 18th century to introduce Western institutions and values into Russia should be rejected, for they undermined the meritorious features of Russian civilization. By contrast, the Westerners, a group with diverse views on how to improve conditions in Russia, tended to be secularists and were highly critical of the historical path their country had followed. Although they were no less patriotic than the Slavophiles, they insisted that Russia was a backward country in need of fundamental change. Some Westerners were socialists, some were liberals, but they all respected the achievements of Europe in science and, more generally, in education, and they favored the replacement of Tsarist autocracy with constitutional government. There is good reason for this sharp divergence of opinion on Russia's past. The history of the country is highly complex, and on many critical developments, the evidence is so scanty that a consensus is hard to come by. Of course, the histories of nearly all countries are replete with uncertainties. But in the case of Russia, an additional factor has stimulated controversy. Ever since the 9th century AD, the country has been subjected to a wide range of different influences whose impact is hard to gauge. Until the mid-13th century, the economic, social, and political institutions of Rus', as the country was then known, bore certain similarities to those in Central and Western Europe. But the Mongol invasions of 1237, which marked the beginning of 2 centuries of foreign domination, deepened the isolation of Rus' from Western Europe that had begun in the late 12th century and influenced cultural trends in various ways. Cut off from the West, Russia remained largely unaffected by the Protestant Reformation in the 16th century, the Scientific Revolution of the 17th, and the Enlightenment of the 18th, all movements that promoted individualism and rationalism. Russia also differed from most European countries in several other respects. The Industrial Revolution, which beginning in the mid-18th century produced vast economic and social changes in the West, did not take hold in Russia until late in the 19th century. Moreover, serfdom, an institution that had largely disappeared in Central and Western Europe by the 16th century, became firmly entrenched in Russia in 1649 when a new code of law reaffirmed the subservient condition of peasants. Serfdom was not abolished until 1861. Moreover, the principle of autocracy, long challenged in the West and seriously undermined by the French Revolution of 1789, remained the guiding principle of government in Russia until 1917. Initially, the word autocrat in the Russian lands referred to a ruler who was independent of any foreign power. But in the late 15th century, and even more so in the 16th, the term referred to a leader with unlimited power. Not all proponents of autocracy agreed fully on its precise meaning, but all tended to favor a definition akin to the one that appeared in 1832 as the first article of the Fundamental Laws of the Russian Empire, the first volume of the digest that listed all laws still in effect. The emperor of all the Russians is a sovereign with autocratic and unlimited powers. To obey the commands not merely from fear, but according to the dictates of one's conscience is ordained by God himself. In short, the emperor's powers were boundless, and in theory the Tsar could do as he wished because he alone was answerable to God. The Tsar set policy, he established the laws of the land, and he was responsible for their enactment. By the early 20th century, this view of governmental authority was the single most divisive issue in the political conflicts that preceded the collapse of Tsarism. In the meantime, the makeup of the Russian state, originally populated predominantly by Slavs, had changed dramatically. The steady expansion of Russia to the east, south, and west, which began in the 16th century and lasted until late in the 19th century, transformed the country into a multinational empire in which some 55% of the population was not ethnically Slavic. Among other things, this development hindered the emergence of a nation-state, a political association with a relatively homogeneous population that shares a sense of nationality. The minorities, of which there were more than 150, spoke their own languages, retained their own cultural traditions, and often were heirs of a long and proud history. Although Christianity of the Orthodox persuasion was the state religion, with more adherents than any other faith, by the 19th century several other Christian denominations had sizable followings, as did Islam and Judaism. Geography. By the early 20th century, Russia appeared to many within the elite to be a clumsy giant, a vast empire comprising one-sixth of the Earth's surface, stretching from the White Sea and Arctic Ocean to the Black and Caspian Seas, to Persia, Afghanistan, India, and China, and from the Baltic Sea to the Pacific Ocean. It was almost three times the size of the United States. The absence of natural boundaries within its huge territory had facilitated both internal migration and territorial expansion, but at the same time it deprived the country of natural defenses against invaders, a frequent threat over the centuries. Populated in the early 20th century by some 130 million people, the country was blessed with abundant natural resources, though they were unevenly distributed throughout the land. In a rough triangle from Lake Ladoga to Kazan to south of the Pripyat Marshes near Kiev, mixed forests predominated. This is the region central to what came to be Muscovy. The climate is severe and most of the land is poor, inhospitable to agriculture. Rye was the staple crop of this zone, though barley, oats, and wheat were also grown. Near Novgorod, some flax and hemp were cultivated. Because of climatic conditions, the region regularly endured droughts and devastating famines. Another zone, known as the taiga, consists largely of conifer forests and stretches north to the tundra and east for hundreds of miles all the way to the Pacific Ocean. The subsoil of the tundra, which extends along the Arctic coast and inland between the valleys and comprises about 15% of Russia's landmass, is permanently frozen. Plants in this region grow for only about 3 months of the year. Its economy depended heavily on the fur trade and to a lesser extent on fishing and the extraction of tar, pitch, and potash, and more recently on coal and minerals. The shore along the White Sea is also rich in salt. Siberia, a huge sector of this region, was known mainly for its furs and some gold. A third zone, the steppes, south of the just mentioned zones, comprises about 12% of the Russian landmass. A treeless expanse from the western border to the Altai Mountains in Central Asia, it included the so-called breadbasket of the empire. It has a variety of rich black earth soils, enjoys dry, warm summers, and was in many ways ideal for grain cultivation. But even here the rainfall is low and tends to be erratic, another cause of the periodic famines in Russia. The extensive and elaborate system of natural waterways, such as the Volga, Dnieper, and Don rivers, the Caspian, Black, and Baltic Seas, Lake Ladoga, and Lake Baikal, greatly facilitated commerce and internal migration. But one serious drawback has hampered commerce. Only Murmansk, founded in 1915 in the extreme northwest of the country next to Finland, borders on an open ice-free ocean and is therefore navigable throughout the year. On the other hand, Russia's natural resources are enormous. No other country can boast of so large a variety of minerals, and only the United States is richer in resources. The empire had about 20% of the world's coal supplies, located primarily in Donetsk, Ukraine, and Kuznetsk in mid-Siberia basins. Its huge oil and gas reserves may have exceeded half the world's total supply. and there were vast supplies of iron, manganese, copper of relatively low quality, lead, zinc, aluminum, nickel, gold, platinum, asbestos, and potash. Well endowed by nature, Russia seemed destined for a long period of leadership on the world scene. But because it failed to discard its archaic social and political systems, Russia could not take advantage of the advances in modern science and technology that, beginning in the 17th century, steadily enriched and transformed Western societies. By the 19th century, Russia lagged far behind much of Europe in economic development, national literacy, and the standard of living of its people. To understand this backwardness, it is necessary to study history, but one should not assume that all students of history will agree on why Russia developed as it did. The question touches on the highly sensitive issue of national identity and is often discussed by even the most learned scholars in charged language that tends to foster disagreement rather than consensus on the nature of Russia's past and destiny. The rise of Kiev. The very first problem that the student of history encounters is the origin of the Russian state. According to the Normanist school of historians, the beginnings of a Slavic commonwealth can be traced to AD 862, when the tribes known as Varangian Rus'es sent an urgent message to Scandinavian princes for help. "Our whole land is great and rich, but there is no order in it. Come to rule and reign over us." The oldest of the three Scandinavian princes, Ryurik, settled in Novgorod in the north, which allegedly became the Land of Rus'. His younger brothers are said to have gone to Belo-Ozera and Izborsk to serve as rulers. Ryurik, the Normanists claim, fundamentally shaped the culture and political institutions of Russia, which during its first two centuries assumed a distinctly Scandinavian character. Although archaeological evidence supports the presence of Scandinavians in Rus' in the 9th century, the Normanist interpretation has been widely challenged and is no longer accepted in its original form. Historians have demonstrated that long before Ryurik appeared on the scene, Slavs in Kiev had assimilated the cultural achievements of numerous peoples who had lived in southern Russia since the 6th century, among them the Sumerians, the Scythians, Sarmatians, the Goths, and the Khazars. In contacts with Hellenic, Byzantine, and Oriental civilizations, these people had developed their own material culture, art, and customs, no less advanced than those of the Scandinavians. Although the Russian dynasty beginning in the 9th century was Norman, the Scandinavian influences on Russia were significant. The basic culture of Russia was essentially indigenous. Whatever the differences over the origins of Russia, all historians now agree that the Kievan state, or Kievan Rus', which emerged in the 9th century and existed for some four centuries, was the first large and powerful Slavic state, and that it strongly influenced the course of Russian history. The Kievan era can be divided into three fairly distinct periods. During the first, from 878 to 972, the princes of Novgorod, successors of Ryurik, expanded into the south and created a vast empire stretching from the Baltic to the Black Sea and from the Carpathian Mountains to the Caspian Sea. The idea behind the expansion was essentially commercial: to gain control of a vast network of commercial highways in the Pontic and Caspian regions. Prince Oleg, who initiated the expansion in 878 or 879, constantly waged war, and when he defeated the Magyars, who migrated to present-day Hungary, the Kievan principality seized control over the whole Dnieper from Kiev to the Black Sea. During his reign, the Russians engaged in extensive trade with the Greeks, the profits from which became the basis of Kievan prosperity. During the second period, from 972 to 1139, Kievan princes sought to stabilize the new state, and a principal means to that end was the adoption of Christianity. Apparently, Prince Vladimir, about 977 to 1015, concluded that if Kiev was to become a major power, it would have to abandon paganism and end Russia's religious isolation. Not much is known about the religious faith of the Russians up to this time, but there is substantial evidence that the Kievans worshipped clan ancestors, who were regarded as guardians and protectors. There is also evidence that Slavs revered rivers, nymphs, and other spirits, as well as trees, woods, and water sprites. In addition, they worshipped gods of lightning, thunder, the great goddess Mother Earth, and Veles, believed to be the protector of commerce. Only the upper classes, it seems, prayed in temples in which priests officiated. How and why Kiev came to adopt Christianity remains unclear. Legend has it that Prince Vladimir sent an emissary to the leaders of the main faiths to examine the beliefs of each. In the end, he allegedly rejected Islam because it forbade alcohol, which is the joy of the Russian, and Judaism, because it was the religion of a dispersed people without a state. More likely, political considerations prompted Vladimir to opt for Christianity. In 987-988, the Byzantine Emperor Basil sought military support from Vladimir to help him fend off attacks from foreign enemies. In return, Basil promised Vladimir the hand of his sister, Anna, an offer that broke with a long-standing Byzantine court tradition against marriage with foreigners. Deeply honored and pressured by dignitaries at his court who had already converted to Christianity, Vladimir accepted the offer, which was conditioned on his baptism. In February 988, Vladimir was baptized and adopted the Christian name of Basil. The Byzantine emperor, behaving in a most unchristian manner, now refused to live up to his side of the bargain. In a rage, Basil attacked Byzantium, and after several victories, he achieved his goal, marriage to a Christian princess. As is often true of converts, Vladimir became an ardent advocate of the new faith. Determined to root out paganism, Vladimir ordered the destruction of all statues of pagan deities, directed the entire population of Kiev, Novgorod, and other cities to be baptized in the local rivers, and took the initiative in having Christian churches built throughout the realm. He also created a church hierarchy and church schools to educate the children of the elite in the doctrines of Christianity. Kiev, where an elegant cathedral was built, soon emerged as the ecclesiastical center of Rus. The metropolitan, ordained by the Patriarch of Constantinople, resided in the city, which now also served as the political center of Rus. For the Russians and for many people in the rest of the world, the country's conversion to Christianity signified that it was now part of the civilized world, not only because the people had turned to monotheism, but also because the conversion added momentum to making permanent the written language, Cyrillic, the early form of which had been invented in the mid-9th century by St. Cyril and St. Methodius. For centuries to come, Christianity shaped much of the nation's culture. It was the critical importance that Russian Christianity came not from Rome, but from Byzantium, where the church was clearly subordinate to the secular ruler. In the West, the church asserted its independence and at times even claimed to be superior to the princely authorities. But in Russia, the church tended to buttress the temporal ruler's claim to supreme power. When Vladimir died in 1015, Kievan Rus's prestige had risen appreciably, but plagued by intermittent outbursts of bloody clashes between political dignitaries, it was nevertheless a politically unstable principality. The underlying problem was the absence of a clearly defined rule for succession. On the death of a prince, his sons often waged war against each other, and only after some had died could a semblance of stability be restored. For example, Yaroslav, 1015 to 1054, succeeded Vladimir, but did not become sole ruler until 1036, when his brother Mstislav died. Despite this instability, Kiev developed into a remarkably prosperous state with political institutions that were in many respects as sophisticated and efficient as those in Central and Western Europe. Kiev's economy. For its economic well-being, Kiev depended on both agriculture and trade, which explains the existence of some 300 cities with a combined population in the 12th century of about 1 million people out of a total between 7 and 8 million. Some 400,000 of the urban dwellers lived in the three major cities, Kiev, Novgorod, and Smolensk. The land in the southern regions of the principality was very fertile, so rich, in fact, that after one plowing it produced excellent harvests for a number of years without any further tilling. The axe was the main agricultural tool, but plows were also widely used for the production of spelt, wheat, buckwheat, oats, and barley. Apple and cherry orchards were widespread in what is today Ukraine. Kievans also engaged in horse and cattle breeding. Slaves, indentured laborers, and freemen performed most of the agricultural work on one of three types of larger estates belonging to princes, boyars, senior nobles, or to the church. Kievans engaged in lively domestic as well as foreign commerce. The North depended on the South for grain, in return for which the South obtained iron and salt. At the same time, the cities imported agricultural goods and exported tools and other manufactured goods. Foreign trade proceeded largely along the Dnieper River and then across the Black Sea to Constantinople, which became the main southern outlet for Russian goods such as furs, honey, wax, and slaves. After the 10th century, the Russians stopped the selling of Christian slaves. The Russian traders, in turn, brought back wines, silk fabrics, art objects, in particular icons, jewelry, fruits, and glassware. Kiev also engaged in fairly extensive trade with the Orient, exporting furs, honey, wax, walrus tusks, woolen cloth, and linen, and importing spices, precious stones, silk and satin fabrics, and weapons of Damask steel, as well as horses. The sacking of Constantinople in 1204 by the Knights of the Fourth Crusade put an end to the Black Sea trade, but some of the slack was taken up by the overland trade between Kiev and Central Europe that had developed in the 12th century. The Russians supplied Europe with furs, wax, honey, flax, hemp, tow burlap, hops, tallow, sheepskin, and hides, and imported manufactured goods such as woolen cloth, linen, silk, needles, weapons, glassware, and metals such as iron, copper, tin, and lead. By the standards of the Middle Ages, the gross product of Kiev was impressive. A small minority, most notably the princes of the major principalities, can be said to have been successful capitalists who enjoyed considerable wealth. On the other hand, laborers were not workers in the modern sense of the word. Most of the people worked on the land as free peasants, and most of the manufacturers were artisans who produced their wares in small establishments. Slaves, generally foreigners captured in wartime, were used to perform household services, but the total number was small. It should be noted that feudalism, the dominant social and political order in Central and Western Europe by the 11th century, did not take hold in Kievan Rus. A personal relationship between nobles under which a lord, the suzerain, granted a fief to a vassal in return for certain military and economic obligations, feudalism was the political and military system of medieval Europe in the region roughly west of Poland. Kievan Rus was organized differently. The upper classes, consisting of the prince's retinue and an aristocracy of wealthy people, merged into the social group known as boyars, whose power and prestige derived from their possession of large landed estates. By the early 13th century, the number of princes, many with relatively small landed estates, had risen substantially, and they came to be regarded as the upper crust of boyardom. Though highly influential, the boyars did not constitute an exclusive social order. Through outstanding service in a prince's retinue, a commoner could rise to the position of boyar, though this did not occur very often. Nor did the boyars enjoy legal privileges as a class. For example, they were not the only people who could be landowners. By the same token, many boyars retained close ties to one or other city. The middle class in Kievan Rus was quite large, in fact, proportionately larger than in the cities of Western Europe at the time, and consisted of merchants as well as a stratum of independent farmers who were fairly well off. The lower classes were divided into several groups. The most numerous were the smerdi, peasants or hired laborers who were personally free, paid state taxes, and performed military service in wartime. But the smerdi did not enjoy full ownership of their property. For example, at a smerd's death, his sons inherited his belongings, but if he had no sons, the property went to the prince, who was authorized to assign a share to unmarried daughters. But unlike the serfs in the West, the smerdi were not legally bound to the land and were not subject to the arbitrary will of the landowner. The political system of Kievan Rus can be described as an amalgam of three features: the monarchic, the aristocratic, and, for want of a better word, the democratic. Although these were closely intertwined, for pedagogical reasons, it is best to discuss each feature separately. Designed originally to prevent discord, the political system had evolved by the 11th century into an incredibly complicated structure that, ironically, tended to generate interminable conflict. Its underlying principle, known as the rota system, was that each member of the House of Rurik was entitled to a share in the common patrimony, the 10 lands of the Kievan kingdom. The senior prince was to occupy the throne of Kiev, and the other thrones would be distributed according to the place of each prince in an elaborate genealogical tree of the family. The only exception was Novgorod, where the prince was elected from the princely family at large. Thus, upon the death of the senior prince, all other thrones would be redistributed. In theory, the scheme seemed ideal, but as the number of princes multiplied, the system became hopelessly confusing. For example, according to the official rules, the elder son of the first brother in a princely generation was considered genealogically equal to his third uncle, that is, the fourth brother. Inevitably, disputes arose over claims to specific thrones, and increasingly, these were settled by the sword. Initially, each member of the Rurik clan considered himself to be the social and political equal of every other member. But the Prince of Kiev, looked upon as the father of the younger princes, enjoyed certain prerogatives that gave him special status. He assumed the title of Suzerain Prince or Grand Duke, and in that capacity assigned the junior princes to their provinces, adjudicated disputes between them, and most important, acted as the guardian of the entire realm of Rus. When major decisions had to be reached, for example, whenever Kiev faced attacks by foreign enemies, the Prince of Kiev would convoke a family council of all the princes. By the end of the 12th century, the elaborate system no longer worked as designed. Increasingly, the Grand Duke treated the smaller princes as his vassals, and the principle of genealogical seniority was often disregarded. Although quite powerful, the princes could not act entirely on their own. In the administration of the realm, the implementation of legislative measures, the codification of laws, and the conclusion of international treaties, the princes needed the approval of the Boyar Council, which represented the aristocracy, the second branch of the political structure. On occasion, the Boyar Council acted as a supreme court. The precise functions of the council were generally determined by custom rather than law. Significantly, the boyars were not obliged to serve any one prince, and could leave at any time to work for the ruler of another principality. Even if a boyar received land from a prince, that did not oblige him to serve his benefactor in perpetuity. The land became the private property of the boyar, who was not regarded as the vassal of any one prince. The Veitchi, popular assembly, represented the third democratic element in the political system of Kievan Rus. All city freemen could participate in its deliberations and its votes, and residents in nearby towns could also attend meetings of the assembly, although generally only the men in the capital showed up. Custom dictated that all decisions be unanimous, but on occasion differences were so sharp that the Veitchi could not reach any decision. Princes, mayors, or groups of citizens could convoke meetings of the assembly, which tended to follow the lead of the princes and boyars in matters of legislation and administration. But after the mid-12th century, some assemblies grew more independent and even played a role in the selection of princes and sometimes went so far as to call for the abdication of a ruler. The socioeconomic and political order of Kievan Rus was thus quite unique, not to be confused with the feudal order dominant in the West. For about 2 centuries, that order functioned relatively efficiently. But during the years from 1139 to 1237, it began to falter. Rivalries between princes and between cities and principalities sharpened, leading to an ever looser federation of Russian states. The growth of regional commerce further weakened the bonds between the principalities. Kiev focused on trade with Byzantium, and, as already noted, after 1204 with Central Europe. Smolensk and Novgorod turned their attention increasingly to commerce in the Baltic region. Ryazan and Suzdal sought to expand their trade with the Orient. The boyars in the various principalities grew stronger and became less and less interested in maintaining close contact with their neighbors. Although the various Russian states did not exactly view their neighbors as foreigners, they did begin to look upon them as outsiders. That the bonds of unity had been frayed became evident in 1237 when the Russians proved incapable of mounting a united stand against the advancing Mongols, also known as the Tatars, who had reached Rus and soon threatened the entire realm. The Mongols had given ample warning of their intentions 14 years earlier in 1223, when they invaded the southeastern region then inhabited by the Polovtsi, or Cumans. The Polovtsi appealed to the Russian princes for help, but only a few agreed to join the fight. In a fierce battle on the river Kalka, the Mongols scored a great victory, but for some reason they withdrew, only to return with a larger force in 1237. The emergence of the Mongol Empire. In several respects, the Mongol Empire, one of the greatest in world history, remains an enigma to historians. It is hard to explain how 1 million people succeeded in imposing their rule over 100 million in a huge area stretching from the Pacific Ocean to the Adriatic coast, from China to Hungary. Although the Mongols dominated Russia for close to 2.5 centuries, from 1240 to roughly 1480, there is still no consensus among scholars about the extent to which they influenced the course of Russian history. That this long tutelage of the Mongols profoundly affected Russia at the time can hardly be disputed. The critical question is whether the conquerors left a lasting imprint on Russian political, cultural, and social institutions. In the 12th century, the Mongols were only one of numerous tribes and clans that lived in the easternmost part of what is today Mongolia, and their emergence as the dominant force was essentially the work of one man, Chinggis Khan, Great Emperor, whose original name was Temuchin. Born in the mid-1160s, Temuchin, as a young man, came to believe that it was his destiny to achieve greatness. One source of his conviction apparently was the legend that one of his forefathers had been born sometime after the death of the mother's husband. The woman claimed to have had a vision of a divine being visiting her at night. It has been suggested that this was an adaptation of the story about the Virgin Mary, which is plausible because Nestorian Christianity had a following among the Mongols. In any case, Temuchin, an intelligent and wily young man, became an outstanding warrior who ingratiated himself with Togrul, the ruler of Karaites, one of the more powerful Mongol tribes. As Togrul's advisor, Temuchin succeeded in changing the rules of steppe politics, which had hampered the development of a stable order. Under the prevailing rules, the loyalty of vassals to their suzerains lasted only so long as it seemed useful to both sides. Each vassal, in other words, was free to abandon his suzerain to join the service of another one. Thus, no one tribal leader could form a large and stable khanate. Temuchin concentrated on securing a large personal following and soon challenged Togrul himself, who was killed probably as a result of Temuchin's cunning plans. Having seized power, Temuchin created a special unit of 150 guards who were charged with protecting him night and day against a surprise attack, a favored political stratagem among the Mongols. Then Temuchin divided the entire army into units of 1,000, 100, and 10 men and enforced rigid discipline in each unit. At the same time, he insisted that all political and military leaders be directly and clearly subordinate to him and forbade them from changing their loyalties. Once he had established his authority over the tribes in his region, by 1206, Temuchin adopted the title Chinggis Khan and then step by step vastly expanded his domain. He defeated the Tanguts, a people of Tibetan origins, and in 1211 he launched a 4-year campaign against the Qin Empire. Within 4 years, he subjugated northern China and Manchuria. He strengthened his forces immensely by incorporating into his army Chinese army engineers and by employing literate Chinese as civil servants. Then, moving westward, he conquered Khwarezm in western Turkestan, an area of the utmost importance for international trade since it lay at the crossroad between China and the Mediterranean world and between India and southern Russia. In the years 1221 through 1223, the Mongols penetrated Russia, from which Temuchin mysteriously retreated after his great victory at the River Kalka. Chinggis Khan died in 1227, leaving a twofold legacy that inspired his successors to continue his policy of military expansion. On the one hand, he had claimed to be driven by a religious obligation to establish universal peace and a universal state. If he conquered the world, he would bring stability and order to humankind, which, in return, would have to pay the price of permanent service to the new state. Under the new dispensation, the poor would be protected from injustice and from exploitation by the rich. On the other hand, Chinggis Khan glorified the military life as a high calling that was deeply satisfying. Man's highest joy, he declared, is in victory, to conquer one's enemies, to pursue them, to deprive them of their possessions, to make their beloved weep, to ride their horses, and to embrace their daughters and wives. Genghis Khan had turned his army into the best in the world, consisting for the most part of superbly trained cavalry accompanied by a gifted engineering corps. It adopted highly sophisticated strategies and tactics to weaken the resolve of the enemy to resist. Long before attacking a stronghold, the Mongols sent secret agents to the region to wage psychological warfare. The agents would spread the word that the Mongols intended to grant religious toleration to dissenters, to help the poor resist exploitation by the rich, and to aid wealthy merchants by making the roads safe for commerce. But at the same time, the agents warned that these commitments would be kept only if there was a peaceful surrender. In the event of resistance, the punishment would be devastating. Once the Mongols had decided on a battle, they would proceed to surround and annihilate the enemy. Applying a strategy known as the ring, the Mongols would occupy a huge area around the enemy and then would gradually approach their quarry. Uncanny in their ability to coordinate their advances, the commanders applied steady military pressure on the enemy. If the enemy lines failed to crack, the Mongols would feign retreat. The enemy, assuming that the invading forces were in disorderly retreat, would rush forward only to be surprised by the Mongols' orderly resistance. The Mongol columns then surrounded the defenders, who found no way of escaping the ring. The Mongols persisted in fighting until the enemy had been utterly destroyed. Mongol domination. In 1235, Ugadai, Genghis Khan's son, decided to attack Europe. After defeating the Bulgars and other peoples in the eastern parts of Russia, 120,000 troops under the command of his nephew, Batu, reached northeastern Russia and inflicted one defeat after another on the local armies. Batu caught the Russians by surprise by attacking in wintertime, a season considered inhospitable to the movement of large armies. The Mongols, used to severe winters, were warmly attired with furs and rode horses trained to gallop on snow, and their armies moved swiftly across the many frozen rivers and lakes. In addition, the Mongols benefited from miscalculations by the Russians and Western Europeans. The Russians believed that the Volga Bulgars would put up strong resistance, but their forces crumbled quickly, enabling the Mongols to capture Ryazan in 1237. Shortly thereafter, the Mongols seized control of Moscow, and in 1238, they entered the city of Vladimir, which they destroyed. The invaders then defeated the army of Grand Duke Yuri II, turned south, and after capturing Kiev in 1240, began to move towards Hungary and Poland. The Western Europeans, disdainful of the Russians as heretics and schismatics, made no effort to help them fend off the Mongols, who in 1241 entered Silesia and almost took Vienna. Only the death of Great Khan Ugadai that year saved the rest of Europe from invasion. Eager to influence the selection by clan leaders of a new leader, Batu withdrew from the west and returned to southern Russia. But the Mongol army did not retreat from Russia, over which they established a rather elaborate system of rule that reduced the Russians to a subordinate position without eliminating all autonomous political life of the local population. It is this duality of the Mongol domination that has led to much controversy about the impact of the long period of foreign rule on the history of Russia. On the other hand, the Great Khan's authority was considered absolute. Once elected by clan leaders, no one could challenge the ruler, who relied upon the army as the backbone of the administrative structure of the Mongolian Empire. The Great Khan issued his orders to army commanders, who acted as civil governors of the districts in which their armies camped. At the same time, most Russian princes retained their posts, but they were clearly in a subordinate position. They were required to travel to Sarai, which was the capital of the Golden Horde, the autonomous state the Mongols had set up west of the Ural Mountains, to kowtow before the Khan, pledge their allegiance to him, and be confirmed in their offices. Any prince who resisted this humiliating ritual was quickly executed. Yet the Mongols showed little interest in exercising direct control over the Russian lands. Their concern was to collect taxes and to secure recruits for their army, but beyond that, they allowed Russian princes to administer their lands. There were only two exceptions to this mode of rule. In southwest Russia, Ukraine, the Mongols removed the existing administrative structures entirely and replaced them with their own, whereas in Novgorod, Mongol agents left the Russian authorities firmly in control at all times. In the late 13th and early 14th centuries, some Russian princes and grand dukes assumed the burden of collecting the tribute for the conquerors, which enhanced their local power and their standing among the Mongols. Eventually, some of these princes grew strong enough to challenge the authority of the conquerors. Such challenges would probably have failed had the Mongol Empire not suffered from endless internal discord. In principle, the Great Khan in Mongolia was the absolute ruler, but the distances between the different regions of the realm were so vast and communications between them so slow that local khans often ignored their leader with impunity, and at times even sought to take over the entire empire. In the 1360s and 1370s, the conflicts reached such intensity that the Golden Horde was virtually paralyzed, enabling Russian princes to play off one khan against another and in the process strengthen their own authority. In the meantime, the impact of Mongol rule on Russia had been substantial. For one thing, the Mongols caused enormous physical damage. A number of cities were entirely destroyed, and as a consequence, Russian industry, enamels, jewelry, ceramics, glasswork, stone cutting, building crafts, suffered a devastating blow, from which it did not recover until the mid-14th century. It has been estimated that during the first 3 years of the invasion, from 1237 until 1240, some 10% of the population was killed. Moreover, because of the decline of industry, internal trade declined markedly, though it should be noted that the Mongols' interest in international trade did stimulate foreign commerce. A major consequence of Mongol rule was the continuing decline and eventual disappearance of the Vechi, the democratic institution of Kievan Russia, in which the lower classes had been able to express their discontents. Their major grievances were taxation and conscription, which placed a special burden on them. Princes and boyars who frequently managed to come to terms with the foreign rulers were inclined to support the Khan's elimination of the Vechi, a potentially troublesome institution for local Russian authorities. By the mid-14th century, the Vechi had ceased to be a significant political institution in much of the country. Another major political change during the era of Mongol rule was the replacement of the rota system, under which Russia had remained a unified state, by the appanage system, under which each province became a separate, divisible, permanent property of a particular prince. Princes no longer moved from one province to another on the death of a prince higher on the ladder of the House of Rurik, and each prince could dispose of his property at will to his wife, sons, daughters, or other relatives, however distant. Historians differ over the reasons for the disintegration of the Russian state into ever smaller appanages, but there is agreement on certain general factors that made it possible. Although the Mongols did not initiate the establishment of the appanage system, they found it advantageous because it made much more difficult a unified stand of the Russians against them. But the geography of the country probably played a more important role. A striking feature of northern Russia was the complex networks of rivers and streams all flowing in different directions, and as people began to colonize new regions, they naturally moved along the waterways. This diffusion of people led to the formation of small river provinces separated from each other by natural boundaries of virtually impassable wilderness. Princes, who often supervised the colonization almost on a day-to-day basis, tended to look upon the new settlements as their own creation and even as their own property, and there were no dignitaries such as boyars to offer resistance to their claims of supremacy. Many of the appanage princes were hardly rich even by the standards of the 15th century, and often they were no more affluent than independent owners of private estates. In view of the political disintegration of Russia, it is remarkable that the Mongol yoke was ever discarded and that a new unified state under the leadership of Muscovy emerged. How that happened will be the subject of the next chapter. Before exploring that theme, however, a few more words should be said about the long-term legacy of the Mongol domination. Although the Mongols left much of the administration to Russian dignitaries, they did contribute significantly to the undermining of the relatively free society of the Kievan Rus by introducing certain elements of what has been called a service-bound society, though the process of establishing such a society was not completed until the 17th century. The following are some of the Mongol practices that left their mark on Russia: the obligation placed on the nobility to serve the state, the right of the ruler to confiscate the estate of a nobleman pronounced guilty of treason, the imposition on townspeople as well as peasants of a tialgo, literally burden or taxes, the introduction of such harsh judicial practices as capital and corporal punishment. Torture became a regular feature of Russian criminal procedures only after the Mongol conquest. It would be misleading to attribute the changes in the institutions and traditions of Kievan Russia solely to the influence of the Mongols, but it would be equally misleading to discount that influence. 2. The rise of Muscovite Russia. Little is known about the origins of Moscow, a town that within two centuries enjoyed a spectacular rise from obscurity to prominence, and that by the 17th century had developed into the center of a vast empire ruled by an autocrat whose powers were unmatched by any European monarch. According to the Russian Chronicles, a primary source for the early history of Russia, in 1147, Yuri Dolgoruki, George of the Long Arm, Prince of Suzdal, invited Prince Sviatoslav of Novgorod-Siversk to Moscow. The host entertained his guest with a mighty dinner, which suggests the existence of a structure of some consequence. 9 years later, Yuri laid the foundation of Moscow by constructing a wooden wall around that building. This small fortress, situated at the western corner of Kremlin, Forest Hill, comprised one-third, or at most one-half, of the territory that the citadel occupies today. Yuri's decision proved to be remarkably astute. Moscow's proximity to the headwaters of four major rivers, the Oka, Volga, Don, and Dnieper, facilitated commerce with various parts of Russia. Close also to several major overland routes, Moscow evolved into a natural depot for refugees fleeing the declining Kievan region, which was repeatedly attacked by Tatar hordes. Moreover, the city's location deep within the Kievan Federation endowed it with the measure of military security. The enemy would attack surrounding cities and then, either exhausted or content with the plunder, would fall back without proceeding to Moscow. Between 1238 and 1368, the city was sacked only once, in 1293. No other city in northern Russia escaped enemy attack for as long a time. It was during this period, in 1263, that Daniel, the youngest son of the highly effective ruler of Vladimir, Alexander Nevsky, became the ruler of Moscow, which was now the capital of a permanent principality. Daniel is considered the founder of the princely house of Moscow. The princes of Moscow made the most of these material advantages. As junior princes, they could not even aspire to the throne of a major principality, and therefore devoted all their energies to expanding their patrimony, generally by the most expedient means. One of Russia's most accomplished historians, V.O. Kluchevsky, has aptly referred to the earliest rulers of Moscow as robbers of the most unblushing type. But in addition, they were crafty opportunists. If they observed that a neighboring prince was momentarily weak, they attacked him without provocation. On other occasions, they resorted to treaties or outright purchase in order to enlarge their territory. Although most of them were neither colorful nor exceptionally gifted, the Muscovite princes seemed to accommodate their policies instinctively to the often changing circumstances. They rarely undertook an action for which they were too weak, and they did not shrink from forming alliances with the heathen devourers of raw flesh, their Mongol oppressors. In short, steadiness, caution, flexibility, and moderation were the hallmarks of their policies. As one commenter noted somewhat ruefully, they did not even carry their tendency to get drunk after dinner to excess. No one exemplified these tendencies more strikingly than Ivan I, nicknamed Kalita, or Moneybags, who ruled Moscow from 1328 to 1340. Some historians believe that he received this name because of his stinginess, but in many folktales, Ivan is depicted as a generous prince who always carried a money bag so that on his travels he could distribute alms to the poor. Whatever the real reason for his name, he was certainly shrewd in handling money. His lavish gifts to the Khan of the Golden Horde were designed to safeguard his principality against attack. Ivan initially ingratiated himself with the Golden Horde in 1327 when he led an army against the Grand Duke of Tver, who had refused to pay the tribute demanded by the Mongols. As a reward for his victory over Tver, the Khan bestowed on Khalidid the title Grand Prince of Vladimir, a position of great prestige that for 100 years was retained without interruption by the Muscovite rulers. Khalidid then assumed responsibility for collecting tribute throughout northern Russia. He performed this task efficiently and ruthlessly, always making sure that some of the funds remained in his coffers. These profits went towards purchasing additional land, which Ivan acquired from impecunious princes, private landlords, and ecclesiastical institutions. The Khan, grateful to be relieved of the burden of collecting the tribute himself, gave his blessing to Ivan's unremitting accumulation of territory. One of the most significant aspects of Ivan's reign was the transformation of Moscow into the spiritual center of the nation. The repeated Mongol incursions into Kiev had induced Metropolitan Maxim to abandon that city in favor of Vladimir in 1299. The choice had proven unfortunate, however, for the secular authorities and the Metropolitan had begun to quarrel, a situation that was soon exploited by Ivan's brother Yuri, then ruler of Moscow, who established cordial relations with Maxim's successor, Peter. During a visit to Moscow in 1326, Peter died, an event that later metropolitans interpreted as evidence of divine selection of the city to be the seat of the Russian Church. One legend that gained currency in the late 14th century maintained that Peter had actually died in Ivan's arms after uttering the following prophecy: "My son, if thou shouldst hearken unto me, and shouldst build the church of the Holy Mother, and shouldst lay me to rest in thy city, then of a surety wilt thou be glorified above all other princes in the land, and thy sons and grandsons also, and this city will itself be glorified above other Russian towns, and the saints will come and dwell in it, and its hands will prevail against its enemies. Thus will it ever be as long as my bones lie therein." Many Russians came to believe in the authenticity of the incident, because 2 years after Peter's death, Metropolitan Theognost suddenly decided to settle in Moscow. From that time, the spiritual and secular authorities worked in close harmony, a development crucial to Moscow's rise to preeminence in Russia. Challenges to Mongol rule. Ivan Khalida's policy of enhancing Moscow's power and prestige was pursued with remarkable vigor by his grandson, Dmitry Donskoy, who assumed the title of Grand Prince in 1359. A talented and courageous ruler, Dmitry determined to challenge the Mongol overlords. Buoyed by his success in fending off the combined military attacks of Lithuania and Tver in the 1360s and early 1370s, he began to defy the Mongols by refusing to pay the annual tribute. In 1378, he added insult to injury by defeating the Mongols in a minor battle near the Vosges River. This enraged the proud Khan Mamai, who realized that if he did not subdue the rebellious Dmitry, Mongol authority all over Russia would evaporate. Mamai organized a huge army, and in 1380, after forming an alliance with Lithuania, crossed the Volga and advanced toward Moscow. In an attempt to settle the issue without bloodshed, Mamai offered Dmitry peace in return for the resumption of tribute in the amount customary before 1371. The Grand Prince responded by appealing to other Russian princes to join in a crusade against the Tatars. Several answered the call, and by the summer of 1380, he had assembled an army of 30,000 men, most from his own principality. Khan Mamai's army was roughly the same size, but he enjoyed the advantage of superior cavalry forces. On 8 September, the two armies stood poised for battle at Kulikova Pole, Snipes Field, a plain between the Upper Don and its tributary, the Dnepr. In accordance with the traditions of steppe warfare, before the fighting began, one of the Tatars challenged the Russians to a duel. A monk accompanying Dmitry's army accepted the challenge and galloped full speed toward his opponent. They collided with such tremendous force that both died on the spot. Minutes later, the two huge armies lunged at each other along a 7-mile front. For 4 hours, Mamai's troops relentlessly assailed the Muscovite army, which was on the verge of total collapse. But Dmitry had cleverly held a large detachment of his best troops in ambush in a nearby forest, and just when all seemed lost, he called on his reserves. The sudden appearance of fresh troops not only breathed new life into the Muscovite army, but demoralized the Tatars. The tide of battle turned completely. Mamai abruptly fled, his army disintegrated, and Grand Prince Dmitry captured the Mongol camp along with large quantities of booty. The Russian force had also lost one half of its men, including the commander-in-chief and several other high-ranking officers. Nonetheless, it was a superb victory, and the first time that a large Mongol army had been routed by Russians in a major test of strength. In the 19th century, one historian interpreted it as nothing less than a sign of the triumph of Europe over Asia. In the wake of the battle, Grand Prince Dmitry's stature rose immeasurably in Russia, not only by virtue of his victory, but also because of his personal bravery. He was the first in battle, notes a contemporary account of the conflict, and killed many Tatars. At one point, he single-handedly took on four Mongol attackers and was knocked unconscious. At the end of the battle, his officers found him under a pile of dead bodies. His armor was slashed to pieces, but he was only slightly wounded and capable of resuming command. Dmitry's joy at defeating the Mongols was short-lived. In 1382, only 2 years after the battle at Kulikova, Khan Toktamwiyish appeared in northeastern Russia with a large army determined to seek revenge and to reassert Tatar authority. Caught off guard, Dmitry, demonstrating none of the acumen or courage he had displayed 2 years earlier, fled to the north to organize a new army. He apparently had persuaded himself that the powerful stone walls of the Kremlin would withstand any Tatar siege. But as soon as he left Moscow, pandemonium broke loose in the city. Wealthy citizens sought to save their lives by quitting the city, but the commoners demanded that everyone remain to help strengthen the defenses against the impending attack. When the well-to-do Muscovites persisted with their escape plans, civil disorder erupted. Many of the people who had packed their bags were killed, and their property was looted as commoners seized control of the city. Distrusting the local nobility, the rebellious peasants chose a Lithuanian visitor, Prince Ostey, to command the garrison. The Muscovites fought bravely, held off Toktamwiyish's army for 3 days, and might have won a great victory had the Mongol commander not resorted to a cruel deception. On the fourth day of the siege, the Khan sent a message to the beleaguered defenders abjuring any intention of causing harm and requesting merely some small gifts and an opportunity to visit the city. Naively, the Muscovites opened the gates to the Kremlin and dispatched a religious procession led by Prince Ostey to greet Toktamwiyish and offer him presents. As soon as the last members of the group cleared the Kremlin gates, the Khan's henchmen pounced on the stunned and defenseless Muscovites, killing the prince and many of his companions. Other Mongols rushed through the open gates or climbed over the walls on ladders that had been held in readiness for the attack. The next few hours were ghastly, as Mongol soldiers indiscriminately cut down local residents, killing, by one estimate, no less than 10,000 people. Toktamwiyish, it appeared, had restored the supremacy of the Golden Horde over Moscow and perhaps over all of Russia. But it soon became evident that because of endless internecine struggles between rival Khans, the Mongols could not exploit their victory of 1382. The Tatars could still cause considerable devastation, as they did when they looted the countryside around Moscow in 1408.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.